Today we have a very interesting and diverse and well-learned panel of folks who are here to share their perspective on this word, this term that we use every day, the word black.
I'm black, whether I'm poor or rich or poor, dog, it's all the same shit. I'm black.
A term of endearment, a term of everyday use, but we want to get a little bit more clarification, a little bit more understanding on the word from the perspectives on the folks on the panel today.
So you're a philosopher?
Yes. 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 I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply.
In about 4 seconds, a teacher will begin to speak.
I think very deeply.
All right, folks, peace. This is your brother, David Rodriguez, and this is another edition of Info Den, information necessary for overstanding. So starting first, we want everyone to give their own introduction.
Peace and love. My name is Oshun L. I am a sheik at the Moorish Science Temple of America. I am also a business owner of Inner Sanctum Mobile Massage, and an investor.
Peace. My name is Kevin C. Meggett. I'm the executive producer of a couple of TV shows, Cap or No Cap, which is a political talk show, Recognized Television, coming out with a couple of documentaries, a Black veteran who honorably served our country in the very first Gulf War. And I also fight for veterans and Black veterans and rights, as well as the rights of Black folk in general here and abroad.
Peace and blessings, everybody. I'm Chuck Cruz, and I run Young, Fresh, and Conscious, which is a training program who train returning citizens, but also grassroots organizations and system stakeholders on new ways and new approaches and fresh approaches on how to work with the community and young people. But we also hold healing circles to be able to gather our strengths, learn from our mistakes, learn from our pain, and come together and build. And I'm happy to be here.
Shalom, shalom, checking in. I go by the name of Bishop Boyde. I'm the senior pastor and rabbi of the Alpha Omega Church of our Lord Jesus Christ, Incorporated. We offer high school programs, OSHA programs, and also resume building and job placement for those in need in the community. And a lot of what we do also is just biblical history and historical classes to get people in tune, you know, with nature and with the creation of the Most High. Shalom, peace, and love to everybody on the panel once again.
Thank you for those introductions. We're going to go right into it. The word black. In your opinion, what does the word black mean to melanated people?
For the masses, it could mean empowerment. But for those that are really, truly woke, it could be a detriment. It depends on what you're using it. So you have at least 85% of the people are, you know, that use the word are probably using it thinking that it's empowering. But you got to also remember it's the 85% that's also the deaf, dumb, and the blind. So those that seek higher understanding or seek outside of it know that black is something, it's really a description. It's supposed to be a shade, a description of a shade, because black isn't a color, it's a shade. And like the word white is just the opposite, it's just the absence of that shade. So when you see melanated people, they tend to gravitate towards a shade, and it's supposed to be empowering. And in most cases, it can be empowering. But when you truly awoke, you know that we are not black. There is no such thing as a black person. We're really more or less copper colored people. But the short answer is, what does it mean? For the majority of people that use the word, they look at it as a word of empowerment.
Because I see it from both the perspective of an Afro-Latino, of a Latino man that is around the Latino community a lot and understand the way of life, but also see it as a Black man, you know, traveling to these regions and working with people and doing the work. So it's really interesting to me how people perceive it. But for me, it means power. You know, it means reconnecting to source. You know, it means unifying, strength, hope, using hip hop, you know, the lifestyle that we come from. But I see a lot of it also meaning a way of life that a lot of people don't want to be a part of. You know, from a Latino standpoint, you know, when they say Black, you know, they immediately look at a lifestyle that they don't want to be a part of because of the backlash that comes with it. Yeah. You know, so I serve as a bridge to kind of, you know, work through those feelings, work through those emotions, but also, you know, learn myself too. Because a lot of my history as a man that comes from Puerto Rico, his roots from Puerto Rico, you know, that history was destroyed. You know, that story was burned, you know. So I'm still gradually just learning, and that's from taking pieces and pieces and just putting it together. So, you know, it's a work in progress. But, you know, it's something that is going to take some time to get people to understand and feel comfortable with getting deep into it, you know, and really understanding what it means, to, you know, to you personally. You know?
I guess just to kind of camel back on what the brother was talking about, just the duality of the situation, where you can see that even within our own communities, where, you know, this is my brother, I'm his sister, and there's still a stigma towards some of our other cultures where the same colonization situation may have taken place. So there is like almost like it's cool in terms of, you know, quote, Black culture, but what does that really come with? Like, what kind of badge do you have to wear in order to be responsible for, quote, Black culture? Okay, that comes with stigmatisms, that comes with inequity, which is an issue in our community. You know, it comes with having to be 10 times as, you know, able or adept at whatever it is you do in order to receive, you know, the same type of accreditation. So, you know, that I was agreeing with Mr. Cruz in terms of that backlash that comes with the nomenclature of Blackness.
I enjoy what the brothers and what the sisters were saying from their perspective of the term Black, and I agree with it all, because just that term and what it is, it's really an abstract term. You know, it's really no wrong or right answer. You know, when I think of Black, I think of our roots. I think of Ethiopia. I think of our motherland. You understand? And I also think about the onyx stone, you know, which you can find on the ephod of the high priest in the Bible. I also think about, you know, the different shades of brown and red that come from that, you know, from our prophets, from our apostles, from our elders, from our teachers, even from the angelic beings. You understand what I'm saying, true? And even the description of Christ and the angels and all other prophets. You know what I'm saying? Even when it speaks about Lucifer, you know what I'm saying, true? Even the book of Isaiah chapter 14, Ezekiel chapter 28 even speaks about the different stones and different places he was at, which is from the root, which is from Ethiopia, from the motherland, even going back to the garden. You know, so when I look at that, man, I think about the Blackness. I go back into even when the girl, when actually one of the princesses was saying, don't look upon me because I am Black, because the sun have looked upon me, you know, in the Song of Solomon, you know, even when she was speaking of herself, and many people think it's Solomon speaking, but it's not Solomon speaking. It's the princess he's speaking, you know, in terms of how she looked, don't look upon me because I'm Black. And a lot of times that word, you know, when people look at it from a different spectrum, you know, a lot of people like to associate themselves with that word, and some people try to dissociate themselves from that word. But the word within itself, you know, is a broad spectrum. Think about even the womb of the woman, you know what I'm saying? The galaxy, that beautiful Blackness, you know, is what it's about, you know? So that's when I look at the word Black, there's different ways you can come and define that.
Sister, I know you have some thoughts on this. Speak a little bit on like the double-edged sword of the word when it comes to like endearment versus status, and, you know, just share a little bit of clarity on that, sister.
Absolutely. I would actually like to start out by saying that when we talk about the word Black, we're not trying to confuse the word Black with what we're all experiencing here, which is race pride. There is a connection between us, no matter what country or languages that we speak, wherever we go, I can always identify someone who's in my empire. This is the connection that we have. That's not quite the same thing as the word Black. And I'm going to be very specific, because when Noble Drew Ali teaches us to reduce things back to a scientific sort of view, and when we talk about things in a scientific manner, you have to remove your emotions, your passions, your past experiences, and reduce things down to what can be proven and what you can find, right? So it requires a whole different spectrum of unbiasedness. But when we talk about the concept of the word Black, Black, according to science, means death, things that we usually describe as being negative, the Black death, the Black plague, you know, being in the Black financially. These are just all scientific terms for Blackness that don't describe what it is that we love about, you know, our quote Blackness, you know, our culture, our heritage, race pride, nationality, etc. Now, the issue, the bigger issue, I would say, with the word Black is that it takes away the concept of nationality. When you're used to being called a certain thing or using a certain word in a certain way, it becomes the new definition of it, as opposed to what the original definition was. If I can get you to never know what it really means, then you'll never have a concept of the true nature of quote unquote Blackness or race pride. You'll always have the definition that I gave you. So when it comes back to a scientific point of view, and I like what the brother Kevin and Pastor Minister Boyd was talking about when they were talking about the scientific aspects of science, of color, especially when we talk about Black. Black essentially is the zero refraction of color, as opposed to whiteness being the full reflection of redaction of all colors, you know, and we're talking about that's what creates light. So, you know, the absence of light and the essence of light. And this is how we describe ourselves in terms of light beings, light people being able to reflect the, now I don't want to get too high into a particular type of science, but when we talked about white people in the beginning, it had nothing to do with nationality, because we refer to ourselves as either, you know, Africanus, Europeans, you know, Nicaraguans, Panamanians. It was very specific because each culture had something, although all the same and although a part of the same empire, very different in terms of what we have to bring to the table, you know? So Blackness kind of puts a veil, like your oppressor says, well, since this is how I identify you, this is what you all are. And that's not necessarily true, because it takes away from what we have to offer to our empire individually, because that's essentially what this is. This is a global, we are a global empire of people, you know, who have colonized all over the world prior to there even being anything to record a colonization with. We were all there. So when we take away that name, and we don't know how to look that up, you know, we just start at Blackness. And that's pretty much starting at slavery almost, you know what I mean? It doesn't give you the opportunity, and you have to work twice as hard in order to really expose that type of history, you know, especially when you're struggling with what the nationalities of our people are. You might not know that you are a Hamathite or a Moor or an Amorite, or any of those other things. You know, we're stuck at, you know, Blackness and Nubia, because Nubia means Blackness, because, you know, that's what they said. And that's not fair when it comes to educating our people in terms of the richness of this empire that we're trying to, I guess, reestablish, you would say. You know, I really applaud this panel of people and how we're able to get together and really talk about it, because it doesn't it's not all the same thing. You know, it's all the same feeling, because what we're feeling, like I said, is race pride. You know, and that's when we feel the power. That's when we feel the pride. That's when we can look on to our ancestors in glory and really, you know, feel empowerment.
I mean, growing up, you know, like, it's an empowering thing. It could be a hindrance thing. The nation of gods and nerfs, you know, in their lessons, refer to the Black man as as God. You know, the Asiatic Black man is the God of the universe. So that's very empowering. But you got to also remember, some folk didn't want to be classified. They were proud of who they were, although they might have been Black, right? But they've never used the term. They may have used the term Seminole. They may have used the term Cherokee. They may have used the term Blackfoot, you know, but these are all descriptions also from another people describing those people, you know. So when you hear a Blackfoot, that's not even an accurate description of that tribe. That's someone else interpreting who you are. But those folk are just as Black, right? But they never claimed to be Black. They claim their identity, and so that's what we're looking at. Those that claim Black really don't have an identity, so they latch on to the word Black, you know what I mean? And Black is just really a description of a color. The people, the true pioneers of Black history, never wanted us to be Black. They inspired us to be more than what we were. And so we have to, I for one personally, I don't have a problem using the word. I don't stay stuck there. So even if I meet my brother there, I'm always trying to elevate him. You know, you were more than just Black, you know? You had a nationality. And so that's what we have to really kind of key in and home in on, is that the mass majority that use the word, it's because they don't have an identity to latch on to say that they were more than just Black.
The term white in terms of status, like, was that something they were using? Because no. We know Europeans grabbed onto it, the lighter skinned ones, but was there ever a time where Black people or melanated people were using the word white for status?
Definitely. And I was trying to think of the actual page number. It would be impossible for me to kind of get into that. But in an archaic sense, and I'm going to try to bring it to history here, in an archaic sense, you know, white means purity, and purity means God, and God means who rules the land. Yeah. So when you get to the people and you change the image of their God, you know, you can, there are many books that show in France pictures of melanated Moses and, you know, melanated hands of God parting the Red Sea for him. Where did they get that from so old back then? You know, so when you changed the image of whiteness by replacing, you know, your oppressing figure who is now a pale skinned person, like, you know, it changes everything, you know? So in the beginning, whiteness was the concept, you know, whiteness was the status of royalty in terms of how much, we talked about light, how much light you can reflect from within is what constitutes your quote whiteness. So fast forward to let's say, you know, 13, 14, 1500s, you know, we're specifically on nationality now, European descent, you know, Africanus descent, Polish, et cetera, Germanic, Romanic, et cetera. You know, I'm trying to think of like the old time, you know, nomenclatures. So now we're tribal, you know, so this is my tribe and we are the tribe of here, and this is your tribe and you are the tribe of there. And then as we continue to today and present, where
a lot of these tribes have been redistributed. It's corporations now, to be quite honest. So, you know, they care not for your tribe. This is who we said we are, and you're outside that bubble as a minority, even though the majority of people in the world would be categorized as a minority. So how are the most people in the world the minority? I don't know. But, you know, when we start isolating ourselves into these little pockets of the countries that we live in, that we helped build, you know, we forget how great our numbers are. So this concept of whiteness, you know, starting, like I said, from a spiritual, scientific sort of standpoint, kind of moves into something else. And I kind of wanted to bring back the word nigger just a little bit, because that wasn't something that we never even referred to us. And I wish that the bishop was here, because maybe he knows a little bit better about the revelations that talks about, you know, the juniper eating people who are hairy.
We're going to touch on that. We're going to get on to the word nigger next.
Yeah,
I want to continue. Right. I want to continue on just this concept of whiteness, not in terms of skin tone, but just on the concept of color. Chav Cruz, I want you to chime in on this. I know in the Afro-Latino community, the Caribbean community, folks who commence in certain spiritual practices, you see this color a lot in terms of the garbs and the garments. Without delving too much into it, speak a little bit about that. What does that mean just for the folks looking in, outside looking in?
You know, negro is the term that's used in, you know, in the Latin community when you are a darker shade than the people around you, right? They call you tu eres negro, right? So it's like a way for them to identify you in the community, right? El negro, right? But in understanding both sides of it, right, you understand the power in being negro, right? Just like, you know, like we just heard here on the panel, but you also understand the backlash that comes from being negro, right? The position in community that it puts you in now being the teacher, right? In now having to share the reasons why you're this color, right? And to explain the reason why you walk this way and you talk this way, right? All of those things is part of, you know, re-educating the community that has been torn from their history and who they are, right? So it's a healing process as well as an educating one, you know, that goes into it. But when you go into the spiritual realm of it, right, when you start to talk about the way that people survived and gained their power, right, color is very important, right, in the way that they describe you know, your purity. You know what I mean? Like, just like Oshun just, you know, shared, you know, white, right? It's supposed to be purity, right? In the Santeria religion, they call it Obatala, right? Which is the Orisha of Orishas, right? So to be, you know, connected to Obatala means that you are, you know, you are connected to purity. You are connected to an energy that is pure, that is fair, that you know, that is healing, right? But when you say that you are black, you know, you are possessed, you know what I mean? You are filled with the spirit, the dark energy, right? They immediately look at that as being bad.
In relation to the church, for those who may not have taken notice, like, speak on that. What is the meaning behind that?
Going into the white in a lot of the churches, that white represents many different things, depending on what type of nationality and denomination it is within so-called Christianity or Hebraic, or however you want to categorize it as, even in some Islamic terms and stuff as well. You know, so the white robes and the white supposed to represent purity. You know what I'm saying, Drew? That's how I look at it as, you know, also as it being, you know, something radiant, you know, as well. You know what I'm saying, Drew? Something being white. Most Catholic churches look at it as being, they use it like as a symbolization, as a dove, you know what I'm saying, Drew? Supposed to represent the Holy Spirit and so forth like that. So they everybody got different terms they use it for, you know, depending on what nationality and stuff it is.
We'll get into this word nigger in relations to the word black. Kev, I'll let you start this one off.
I use the word. It's ironic that it does hold a dual meaning too, because what's the root word of a nigger? Negus. Where did that come from? What does that mean? So, you know, we gotta think, take things back sometimes to its essence. You know, anything that became disparaging from us, it probably came out of envy. You'll find a lot of disparaging coming out of envy. And so Negus is an Ethiopian word meaning royalty. Hmm. Not too many people knows the difference. Again, I use it because when I use it amongst people that I know, I'm thinking that I'm using it as culturally as we're both on a plantation. That's my nigga. Yeah, I'm your nigga. You know what I mean? But if a white person used it, I'm trying to take their head off. Yeah. Period. Because they were the slave. It's weird because they were the overseers and the slave masters. You know, same thing with like the word Sambu. Sambo came out of the word Sambu. Was Sambu? Well, that was the Indian god. You know, so a lot of these words, you know, we talk about black, black having dual meanings. The word nigga have dual meanings. The word Sambo has dual meanings. You know, it's just I tend to worry about not what a person call me, but how they treat me. You know, so I don't know if that was a right or wrong answer, but it was a very honest answer.
We were talking about the word nigga, and I believe the sister wanted to get a biblical perspective on the word nigga in terms of how it's used. I know it's in there. I believe it's in the book of Acts. Put a proper perspective from what you know on that word and how it's used in the Bible.
The brother I just spoke just now, he spoke about the Ethiopian word, the Negus word. So when you go to the word in the book of Acts, the 16th chapter, it speaks about the word Niger, which is spelled I-N-I-G-E-R. So at those particular times, during that region, the people of like the Nile and of the Nigerian and of those certain Judea regions and stuff like that, those was people of color. And also, just to put it out there, even Christ himself wasn't a very handsome man. He was what you call like an ink spot, very dark-skinned. And the Bible declares that when we would see him, there would be desire that we would acknowledge him. So he didn't come like as a Messiah would look. You know what I'm saying? So he came from Nazareth, from the slums, which is modern term ghetto, Nazareth. But that word, Niger, the Europeans took it and used it into a derogatory term. You know what I'm saying to you? And add another G-N-I-G-G-E-R. So a lot of times when that word, especially when you're dealing with a lot of our elders and ancestors and stuff, they don't even want to even think about that word because of the history behind just that and how it was used during the times of our ancestors being in slavery. And even some of our so-called elders today don't even like when people use that word, or even when we use the word, which sometimes we would like to say, well, N-I-G-G-A, which they speak about another end of his goals getting accomplished. Even the fact of the word, they don't want to look at it as something being positive because all they know is the bad history behind it. But going deep with that word does go back to emperor, and those does go back to kingship. Just that a lot of people don't know that because a lot of the information in the translation was a transliteration of a mistranslation. It was destroyed and it was taken away and stuff like that. So this is why a lot of the information that was put out was a lot of misinformation instead of the information that was supposed to have been here to us. But that word, behind that word, does go back to a greater title and greater definition, which goes back to emperor and dealing with that in those times.
I think we covered a good amount in terms of this topic. We want to, before we head on out, we just want to give everyone an opportunity to kind of share their final thoughts. Share some of your final thoughts for the people out there. Let them know, give them some updates in terms of this topic, what we said, and anything else you may have going on.
Shalom, mashbaka, utep, shalom, peace, and blessings. I think this discussion was an excellent discussion. More of this needs to be happening on a weekly basis. Not only was it a good discussion, it was a very educational discussion. And this is something that a lot of our young viewers and young listeners need to listen to and be informed with, you know, versus it was a lot of peace, a lot of harmony. Nobody was cutting nobody off. And this is the type of energy and attention that needs to be shown on InfoDen and all across the board. I enjoyed everybody's comments from my sister, from my brothers. So this right here is what's needed. And it would need to be said, you know, versus everything else in a nutshell. If anyone knows anyone, adults that's interested in obtaining the high school diploma equivalency, work readiness, or anyone that wants to get in the construction field, they can email me at pastorboyd@pastorboyde@gmail.com. I'm also on Facebook as Bias Boyd Controversial. I'm on there. So the order of services and other things that we offer to the community is also there as well. And also continue to look forward and look for me more on InfoDen. We have a lot of projects that we're putting together for the community.
Chef Cruz, anything, any final words, any final thoughts you'd like to tell the people?
I agree with what brother was saying, man. This was a great discussion. I learned a lot, you know, like I said in the beginning, you know, I'm still learning. And it's important to still learn so to be able to share back, you know, and be that bridge, you know, because this is a constant process, you know. So I'm grateful to be a part of this process, man. And I'm excited about this project that I've been part of that's coming out on Sunday. You know, this is something that has been a part of me for a long time, being a double minority and being able to navigate that here in the South Bronx. Know, now being able to travel to these regions and actually be in these, you know, places where there's a lot of racism and be that bridge and kind of break those type of barriers. So I'm blessed to be in this opportunity, you know, to be connected to so many, you know, people that's just conscious and aware and really knowledgeable of what we need as people, you know, to heal and come together, you know. So you can contact me to just kind of share and build at chevcruzyfc@gmail.com. And we can build and share. And I would love to learn from you guys more. Just go from there.
Kev, man, let them know. Give me final thoughts of the topic of what the things you're working on.
I love what you're doing. It's a great platform. I agree with everyone that spoke before me. Remember, knowledge is key. And the application of knowledge is power. So, you know, grab the key and get empowered. Any veterans looking for to connect to veteran services, reach me at Kevin C. Meggett, Meggett@gmail.com. Again, I'm mostly on Facebook. I'm on all social media platforms, but I'm mostly on Facebook. I frequent Facebook a lot. And again, I have a TV show called Cap or No Cap. It's a political talk show. And recognized TV. And, you know, I'm doing a lot of independent projects with television and film. And I want to thank everyone that blessed this panel. It was a very meaningful discussion. And looking forward to more like that. And I would like to thank you, Dave, for putting something like this together.
Oh, man, thank you for being here, brother. Well said, man. And Sister Oshun L, let them know final thoughts, topic we discussed, and any information you would like to put out to the people.
Certainly. Everyone continue to read. You know, a terrible person once said, if you want to keep something away from us, you know, put it in a book. And that's definitely not true. I encourage people to continue to look into their nationality. You know, if you have race pride and you think your condition can improve, join the Morris Science Temple of America. You know, learn about a different aspect of spirituality, about civics, how blackness pertains to us in a lawful sense. It's just all really interesting, and I'm just really honored to have the platform to talk with all of your awesome panelists and, you know, discuss these things. In terms of myself, if you want to get in touch with me, you can find me on Facebook, Oshun L, or you can contact me directly at contact@innersanctummassage.com. I'm currently working on a healing touch online course, so that's going to be something that you're going to be seeing from us soon. in terms of how to use, anyone can be a healer with their hands. It's just something you have to tap into. So thank you guys, I appreciate it.
Once again, this is your brother David Rodriguez for Info Then, information necessary for overstanding. Peace and good night.
Peace.
So you're a philosopher?
Yes. 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 I think very deeply. I think very deeply. I think very deeply.